Right. Good.
So we are in verse 20. Yeah? So let us read together. Verse 20. Now, then we are ambassadors of Christ, as thought God, he beseech you by us. We pray in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we God, we thank you, Lord, for the blood you shed. We thank you, Lord, for bringing us back to yourself. Your grace and your mercy, Lord, has provided a way, Lord, to go back to God. Father, we are thankful this time. Bless the name of your word. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray and we say, Amen.
Amen.
And God bless you. So, today, we're going to study this word, the reconciliation. Who can tell me the meaning of this word, the reconciliation? You know the word, reconciliation. Sister Bishop, can't remember. But this is what's happening in our daily life. The reconciliation. What it means to be reconciled to anyone. Sister Eric, can you tell me? You stand up.
Bring back
what? Yes, if some people they are separate or they argue each other, they are in conflict. You know what conflict means? You know conflict. Two people, let's say, are not talking to each other, something like that. Yeah, there's something between them. They are not friends anymore. Like you said, you are not my friend anymore. Don't talk to me anymore. You understand? So that means there's a separation between two people. Okay? So, what is the reconciliation? The reconciliation is to bring those two people together. You understand? That's what we call the reconciliation. And the conflict is like, you're not talking to each other. You've got something, maybe you've been arguing about something, yeah? And you think that you are right, and other person also thinks is right. So you just finish like that. You don't get the solution in the problem, and you just separate yourself. So you are in conflict. You understand? And to finish that conflict, and to bring those people together is what we call a reconciliation. Do you understand? Is it clear? So, my title is, subtitle is the purpose of redemption, the purpose of the redemption. So, why the redemption? What is the meaning of redemption? Do you know? To redeem, what that means? You don't know. To bring back. You understand? So, before to be redeemed, you must come there. Let me give an example. You go to the pawn shop. The pawn shop is where you go. I'll take my iPad. The pawn shop, okay? Oh, let me take my Bible to the pawn shop.
No, they don't have a Bible.
They're refusing. So I'll take my iPad to the pawn shop. I'll say, okay, I need some money. If you can lend me some money, then I'll pay back. But when I'll pay back with profit. Yeah? I'll pay back more. Let's say they tell me that, okay, how much do you want? I said, I want £100. I said, I'll give you my iPad. Yeah? So, on my iPad, and you give me £100. They tell me, when you come back, that if money you pay 100 pounds and 110 pounds. Okay? So I said, okay, that's fine. So what I'm doing, I'm going to use that 100 pounds. And I'll take 110 pounds to go. Do you think I'm going to buy the iPad again? What I'm going to do? I'm going to redeem it. Because it belongs to me. You understand? That's what we call a redemption. You understand? So now, there's no time for questions. Keep the question. So now, us as a children of God, okay? We're lost, okay, in this world. And God wanted to redeem us. That's what we call the redemption. So the purpose of the redemption is to reconcile God and his children. Are you with me? Are you with me?
Yes.
So that's the purpose of the redemption. So the redemption means, what the redemption means? To bring back. That means, that's why I'm telling you, before to be redeemed, you must be a child of God to be. And we call it But to begin with, you must be a child of God. Every.
Yes.
So that's what we call the predestination. Okay? Predestination. Okay. Let us read it together.
Predestination.
Again?
Predestination.
Predestination. So we were predestinated by God. Okay? Because we are the children of God. I'm going to give you an example. Did you choose to be the son of your father? No. But you came from him. That the reason is taking care of you. The only reason is taking care of you because you are part of him. Do you understand? And I don't think your dad is taking care of all the children in the world. He's not going to manage anyway. You don't have enough money to do that. No one can do it. Amen. But his responsibility is to take care of his offspring. Do you understand? To take the responsibility of his offspring. You know what offspring means? So you need to study words, guys. Offspring. I think it's like this, isn't it? But I like it. Is it like this? Offspring. So offspring, what's his name? Can you tell us what offspring means? Stand up, tell us. So you see, me, I'm the offspring of my father. Do you understand? Do you understand? No. So your father, your dad, yeah? He's got children. She's a Rebecca, Israel, Joseph, Mother Christian, Jordan, Mother Prince. So now, she's a Rebecca's going to get married. So she's going to have children, and brother Israel is going to get married, he's going to have children, all of you, okay? And all of your children, they are the offspring of brother Christ. Catch it now. That's what we call the offspring. And Jesus was an offspring of David because he came from David's family. So offspring is actually like a family. Family tree.
Yeah.
Family tree, that's the offspring. So when we'll be studying those things, so we must get idea about what we're talking about. Alright? So now, so predestination means that we are the offspring of God. You understand? That the reason God had to redeem us back. Do you know that Satan also was in heaven? Satan was in heaven. But he rebelled himself against God. And what God did, God cast him away, cast him down in the earth. And since that time, God didn't redeem Satan. Do you know why? Because Satan is not a child of God. There is no redemption for Satan. You understand? So now, there's no way for God to be reconciled with Satan. And God, when Adam fell in the Garden of Eden, God came with the redemption to redeem him back to him, to reconcile with him through Jesus Christ. Who is Jesus? The Word. You understand? So, let me tell you this. Outside of Christ, there is no redemption. So by this, you understand that all the religions, okay, in
They are lifeless.
You understand? It's just a ritual, a tradition. You see, Muslims, they're going to do it, sit down and go. They're doing nothing. It's just a religion. And what I'm saying is that Satan can come in many ways. You understand? It's the same Satan coming in many ways, but the Spirit of God comes only by one way. You understand? And one day the children of Israel, right? They said, Moses, why didn't you tell him how to speak to us? So we are tired of you. Moses said, what do you want? He said, so you need to tell God to speak to us too. We want to listen to God ourselves. We don't need someone to be between us and God. Tell God to speak to us. Moses said, all right, okay. I'm going to ask the Father if he's going to do it. And Moses went to the mountain and spoke to God. He said, Father, they want to listen to you, Israelites. Can you speak to them, please? God said, why? He said, because they want to. He said, okay. Give them an appointment. Tell them to come to the mountain such and such time, so I will talk to them face to face. And Moses went down and said, okay, God is happy to talk to you. Are you ready for that? He said, yes, that's what we've been looking for. We didn't come. Amen. So the time came, so they came down to the mountain. So they were waiting for the Lord to speak. And when the Lord started, I am your God, they started screaming. Moses said, I think you wanted to listen to him. He said, no. Fine. And God stopped. And Moses said, so what do you want? He said, Moses, we understand that we can't talk to God. Because you are a prophet, you go to God, let God talk to you, and don't you come and talk to us. You understand? So it was chosen by man himself. So that's the reason. You can't go back to God outside of the prophet Balaban. You understand? If you go to the church, they don't know Balaban. They don't talk about Balaban. I'm telling you, they are lifeless. Amen. Amen.
Do
you believe it?
Yes.
So Balaban was God's provided way for the reconciliation in this time. Are you with me? So God has got his provided way. So let's say this. Junior is a baby. Right? So mom will come to Junior and say, Junior, you are born in 2017. So you know this is a modern time. You got iPads, iPhones, everything. So Junior, when you're hungry, just ring the bell and I'll bring you milk. So Junior is only 2 days old. Do you think Junior is going to do it?
No.
Let's take Ezra, the little baby. So, Sister Grace will say, Ezra, my baby, you were born in 2016. In this time, we've got iPads, we've got iPhones, everything. So when you are hungry, just ring the bell and I'll bring milk for you. Do you think Ezra is going to do it? Why? Because it's not God's provided way. Do you understand? So if you are coming to God outside of his provided way, God is not going to accept you. You are not. Are you with me? Do you understand? Isn't it easy? Right. So, what Jesus is going to do? What Ezra is going to do? Do you know when Ezra asks something? He cries.
That's the way Ezra can speak to mom and dad. So Ezra is going to cry. What mom is going to do? Mom is going to feed Ezra. Ezra will go. So mom understands that it's not what Ezra wants. So what mom is going to do? She's going to check the nappy. You understand?
So if she checks the nappy is fine, and Ezra's still crying, there's something wrong. Do you understand? Maybe something wrong with the baby. So what mom is going to do? Mom is going to take Ezra to the hospital. So that's the provided way for Ezra to communicate with mom. You understand? But sometimes when he's praying, mom is going to feed Ezra. When Ezra starts feeding and stops crying, see, he's crying. He knows that we are talking about him. So when Ezra goes starts feeding on the milk, yeah, on the bottle, and stops crying, that means Ezra was asking for milk. So if you give milk, he refuses, and you check the nappy is dirty, that means that Ezra was crying for the nappy. So when you change it, he starts now laughing. That's the only way Ezra can speak to mom. Hence, it's called God's provided way. Do you understand? So God's provided way today is the prophet. So if you are trying to come to God outside of the provided way, God will never listen to prayer. Do you understand? So in that time, there was Philistines, there was Amorites, all those people, they were religious people as well. They used to pray, but the Ark of the Covenant was with the children of Israel. The only way God can hear their prayers must be near the temple, because God was dwelling there. You understand? So those Amorites, they were making their own gods, trying to figure out what God is. But the true God, the creator of the heaven and earth, was dwelling with the children of Israel. And today, the creator of the heaven and earth, which is Jesus Christ, the pillar of fire, the God of glory, was dwelling in Bora Bora in the time when he was here. And when Bora Bora went back home, where's Jesus now? Where's Jesus Christ now? Huh? In us. Because he said, in that time the world will see, won't see me no more. But you will see me, because I will be with you, even in you. You understand? So God in his people. But when I'm saying that, God in nature, God in his son Jesus, and God in his people. So the meaning of that was God wanting to reconcile the world to himself. How do you feel? Yeah? Do you understand? But Christian, how do you feel? Good. So the Bible says this, and all things are of God, who have reconciled us to himself by Muhammad, by Hindu, by Jesus Christ. And who's Jesus? The Word. And the Word is not the Bible. The Word is now the pillar of fire, the Logos. It's called the Logos. Are you with me? The Logos. Why? Because that pillar of fire was in Moses, right? And when Moses was doing things for God, it was God in Moses doing those things, and they took what Moses did and they wrote it in the Bible. That's the reason we call it the Word of God. Do you understand? So the Bible is the manifestation of the Word in God's people. Do you understand? Because the Bible says that in the beginning was the Word. First John. Yeah? John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, but the Bible doesn't say that in the beginning was the Bible. So in time of Adam and Eve, there wasn't Bible. Do you know that? You say amen or no?
Amen.
So, but the word was there. Do you understand? So the word is the manifestation in God's people, and it was written in the Bible. That's the reason Peter said, "We you are the chapter of the Bible." No, Paul said, "You are the chapters, you are the pistols of the chapters of the Bible." You understand? So it could be Brother Israel chapter 5. Yeah, because you are the written word, the word is manifested in you. Because you can't add in the Bible, it's finished now, but you could add. And keep, but what I'm saying that you can add your things in the book of Acts. But what I'm saying, the book of Acts is the work of the Holy Ghost in the apostles. You understand? So every believer can add his own testimony in the book of Acts. Amen. So the way that God was in Christ. So who was in Christ? Who was in Christ? No, we are reading there. 19. The way that God was in Christ. Who was God?
Logos.
Yes. He was in Christ. You understand? So, let us do this. Okay, this is Christ, okay. And God was in Christ. Okay? So this is Jesus. Okay? And this is God. The purified. Yeah. So why God came in Christ? To do what? To redeem us. But when the Bible says that, to wit that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. Do you understand? So, after the fall, God was spirit. Okay? It was impossible for God as spirit to redeem Adam. In God's law is the kinsman redeemer.
You are learning a lot today, isn't it? I'm going to slow together. Quite too much for you. So we are going to meet us by my random Scott and we are going to stop there. So
in the God's law is a king's man redeemer. Yeah. King's man. Okay. King's man redeemer. That means the nearer parents. Someone who's near to you, close to you. You understand? To redeem. In time of Boaz and Ruth, do the story. Yes. So, Naomi has lost everything because Elimelech, who was the husband, died. When she came back, she didn't have anything. But in the time of the Jubilee, 50 years after, they're supposed to get back all their goods, their things, field, everything they had after 50 years. But there must be a kinsman redeemer, someone who is close to Elimelech to redeem all the things back. You understand? And Boaz was the kinsman redeemer for your understand? And Boaz got married to Ruth. By Ruth, he redeemed the things of your you understand? So now God to do it, to redeem Adam. Adam didn't have father any money, isn't it? So God has to come himself to be manifested in the human flesh to redeem Adam back, to reconcile Adam to himself. So what God did? God spoke the word and Jesus the flesh was created and God came to dwell in Jesus. Do you understand? That's why we say
that Jesus was 100% man and 100% God. Okay? So the flesh of Jesus wasn't God, but the spirit in him was the living God. Why? To redeem back Adam to himself. Because Adam didn't have any dad or mom, so God as his father is supposed to come himself to redeem Adam.